informational. I basically, just so you're aware, the handout is my notes condensed, okay? So what I did is I have my notes, but because my notes are for me, meaning I write, so my brain triggers things, they may not trigger things for you. So I remove lots of things just to keep it more informational, so you can follow along if you'd like. We're going to be in Genesis chapter 1. The title I've given is In the Beginning, God. Okay, this is a very powerful verse. So I'm going to read it, then we'll pray, and then we'll get into it. It says, In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Let's pray for the message. Dear Lord, I just thank you so much for today. Thank you for this time. Just pray, you just give me the words to say. Just pray for this message, that it be fruitful. I just thank you so much for giving us your word and just showing us what did happen at the beginning, Lord. We just thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so it's a very, I love it. It's just, the Bible starts off, it just really just kicks off straight to, it's just in the beginning. And when we look around, it kind of makes sense to us. Everything has a beginning to us. Okay, I say this way for a reason. When I look at this building, I don't assume it existed forever. It did not exist at one point, and then it had a beginning. When I look at my kids, they have a beginning. They didn't always exist. That would be weird. They definitely have not. So everything we look at, we just assume there's a beginning, okay? And that's the way we work. But the interesting part is God does not. He doesn't have a beginning. Many people, it's interesting, they might be able to accept the idea that the universe has a beginning, but then you'll get people that, well, who created God? What's God's beginning? And I've heard this question, because again, I teach students, and they have asked, because I give a moment of time for asking, and it's amazing what they ask, but some people ask, well, I get the part of beginning, because that's what we think. Everything has a beginning, but what about God? Well, what about God? I want to point out something in Isaiah 55, verses 8 through 9, just to kind of point out some things with God. It says, For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than yours, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Isaiah 55, verses 8 through 9. I just want to put that out. God's way of doing things, we're not going to fully comprehend. It's so far above us, okay? His thoughts are very far above us. So we're not going to fully be able to comprehend God. He created us. Now in the verse, I want you to note something. The first point I want to bring out is God is. He just is. In the beginning, God. Now I want you to note, it says, note the phrase in the beginning. It's not referring to God's beginning, but the act of creating the very first thing to exist in our world, universe, creation. It says, in the beginning, God created. Well, in order to have a beginning, what has to be there? Time. Time. What's interesting is if you actually take the first verse, time, space, and matter are present. They're created. You have, in the beginning, time is now a concept that can be understood. God created the heaven, you have the space, and then created the earth, which you had the matter. Now you have the three things that God uses to continue through the creation. And we'll go more in depth on that as we go through the creation. Today, we're mainly going to be focusing on verse 1. Which I want you to note, it just so happens time is mentioned, but it's saying that at the beginning of time, God created, and he created something. What did he create? Heaven and earth. But they are not required for God to exist. God is. I would like you to go to, keep your spot in Genesis 1, but go to Exodus 3, 14. It's a really powerful statement that God makes to Moses. I'll go to verse 13, and it says, "And Moses said unto God, Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and they shall say unto them, The God of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, What is his name? What shall I say unto them?" Verse 14, "And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you." That's a very powerful statement. God is the only one that actually can say that and be 100% accurate. He is. God is the only one that can always refer to himself as I am. It means to just exist, be ever present. He just is. He's present in all places, at all times, all the time. When he says I am, he is present at creation, present talking to David, present dealing with Abraham, present at the cross, present at the end during judgment. Throughout the concept of what we call time, he is. He just is. He's not like he was something or is something. He is, never changing. He's outside of it. Interestingly for us, God does not open the Word, the Bible, with a justification for his existence. He doesn't attempt to prove who he is. Again, he just is. It's a fact. It doesn't say in the beginning, there was a being called God. And this being, this is not what it says. This is in the beginning, God created. He's not sitting there trying to say who he is, where he came from, his background, nothing. He just is. It's a fact. He doesn't need to explain himself. He will not do that. He doesn't have to. And there's a reason he doesn't have to, actually. There's a good Psalm 14:1, which is going to kind of go into why he doesn't have to explain himself. It says, "To the chief musician, a psalm of David." This is Psalm 14:1. It says, "The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. They have done abominable works. There is none that doeth good." Interestingly, it says the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. God doesn't have to defend himself. God doesn't have to prove his existence. He just is. And here's the thing. We know it. We can ignore it. We can lie to ourselves. But that's foolish. It's foolish because we know he exists. Now, that doesn't mean you know him personally. The Bible introduces you to him, shows you more of the plan, gives you more detail into the problems, shows you the solution, allows you to grow, allows you to walk. There's a lot there, but the fact that he is known. It's foolish because the knowledge of him is in us. This is in Romans 1:19-21. Just go ahead and turn there, if you would, and so we can see this. Romans 1:19-21. I'm sure many of you heard this verse before. Romans 1:19-21. It says, "Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them." Verse 20, "For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse." Then we get to verse 21. It says, "Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened." I want you to note something. Verse 20, it says, "For the invisible things of him," God, "from the creation of the world." So the invisible things of God from the very beginning, the verse we just read, "In the beginning God created," from there to now, and as we go through, they're clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. The things that are made is everything he created. understands there's a God. Now, we could see that when Jesus Christ actually is on the boat and tells the wind and the storm to stop, it heeds his voice and stops. Okay? The devils know he's true, and they tremble. People know he's real, but they choose to ignore or follow. We know. God's put it in us to know. Again, why did he do this? Well, so we can know him. But the other reason is, for those that don't want to follow, we have no excuse. And it's interesting, in verse 20, it says, even his eternal power and Godhead is understood so that they are without excuse. The creation screams powerful, order, design. It's funny because I've read some articles. I was listening to an interesting conversation. It had like some people that you might be familiar with, Francis and Genesis and some other creation places. And they were talking about the vastness of the universe and just the fact that it just shows how powerful and grand God is. The interesting part is, on the flip side, I have sadly a family member who is not saved. He's very wealthy and kind of finds his joy in, shall I say, confidence in his wealth. He posted a thing that's an atheistic thing of the universe, and it was saying, oh, the chances, the vastness of the universe, and only Earth has life, and out of all that, that's the one that God wants to, they don't look at it right. The thing is all of it's created for his glory, and he created it for him. And then he created man, which we'll go over later, and put him on Earth, and gave him this thing called free will, which we'll discuss, where we could choose not to follow him. That doesn't mean he doesn't exist. And the interesting part is, he put it in us to know he exists. That's why it's foolish. It doesn't mean dumb, like you're dumb or stupid. That's not what it means. Foolish is you know, right? You know what you should be doing, yet you don't do it. It's foolish. We see that all the time, especially if you're a young boy. I'm not sure about the women. Maybe they do the same thing, but young boys do foolish things a lot because they know how to do it right, or they do it right, but they're like, nah. Like, you know, you're on top of a really tall fence. You look down and say, I could probably make that. Probably foolish. You find out that when you fall, next thing you know, it was a little higher than anticipated, but you had it imagined in your brain a certain way. It was a foolish act, even though there might have been a ladder right over there. We do foolish things. Foolishness is basically you know what you should do, yet you don't do it. Or you know something's right, but you don't acknowledge it. It's foolish. It's not ignorance. There's a knowledge. So again, that's why the Bible says a fool has said in his heart, there is no God. It's foolish because we know. And so in the beginning of the Bible, God does not need to justify or explain his existence. It just states it as a fact because it is a fact, and he puts it in us to know it's a fact. Now, that doesn't mean you know him. Again, I'm not saying you know him. It doesn't mean you're going to know all about him. It doesn't mean you're going to understand the Trinity or the fact that the Son of God, the Holy Spirit, but you know there is a God. You know. Creation speaks it. And we're just logically speaking, it makes sense. If I look at this building, I look at these pews, I don't go, wow, that's so awesome. I walk in here, it is a miracle that all these pews came together the way they are in the places they are, and we actually trust them enough to sit in them. That seems weird to think that would accidentally happen. Yeah, we'll look at creation, and people will say, oh, yeah, that was an accident. They know it's foolish. It's foolish. So point one, God is. He just is. He doesn't have to defend it. He doesn't have to prove it. He just is. And here's the thing. If you're sitting there saying, or someone watching, or someone says, well, no, he doesn't. No, he deep down, you know. Deep down, you know. Deep down, you know. And you can't ignore it. The Bible says it's just foolish to do so. Another thing I want to point out in the beginning, when it says in the beginning God, Jesus is, I say is, was, he is. But in the flesh, that's where the was comes in. He was there and created. Christ is throughout the Bible. Throughout it. And as we go through Genesis, you're going to see that. But he's at the beginning as well. I want to note something here. When you see the word God in our English translation here, that's actually Elohim. That's the word being used. And the word God throughout most of Genesis 1 is Elohim. This is a singular masculine noun that has a plurality of God. So it is a name that's there that means one God with plurality. So it's showing there's already a pluralization here, Father, Son, Holy Spirit present, but again, it is a singular masculine noun. So it's still one God, but three. Now, we know three because you study farther. If you just read the first verse, you wouldn't know that, but they are present. I'll point that out in a second. Again, trying to describe the Trinity is maybe not fun for some, but it's interesting because here's the thing. You're never fully going to grasp it. That's like a three-dimensional being trying to explain to a two-dimensional being three dimensions. The two-dimensional being can only go so far. And here's the crazy part. If the two-dimensional being sees three dimensions, are they really seeing the full extent of what three dimensions has? No, because they're a two-dimensional being. They cannot see it. That's why when you read the descriptors of heaven, they're trying to do the best they can with what they know. It's like a lion. It's like a dove. It's like this. It's kind of like this because they have no idea what it is, how to describe it. It's got a face like a man, is it? No. But that's the best I could do because that's all they know. They're trying to describe it as best they can. God is, again, above our ways, above our thoughts, okay? He created us. Now, we're trying to describe aspects of him. You can only go so far with the knowledge we have. We are stuck within our creation. Our mentality and knowledge and understanding is within the confines of that. So again, trying to understand the Trinity is kind of rough. You just kind of have to accept it is, because he says it is, and we'll see that as we go farther in Genesis 1, or you don't. But there's a problem if you don't, because they are present. The Holy Spirit, the Son, the Father, they're all equal. They're not ranked. They're all equally God, and they all serve. They all do a purpose. 1 Timothy 2:5, just so you state, this is again scripture, it says, for there is one God. Okay? And one mediator between God and man, Jesus Christ, or Christ Jesus. There is one God. The three is not multiple gods, it's not the case. He states it, he's one God. Right? Again, we'll see more of this as we go through the days of creation. On the fact that he's just one God, and we also see that Elohim is used throughout the chapter, which we'll go over more. But what I want to do is I want to show that Jesus was there and is there. John 8:58, it says, and Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Now, this is Jesus himself stating that before Abraham even existed, he is ever existent. Let's go there. I just want you to see, because I want you to see some other verses after it. John 8:58. Now, I'll give a little bit of more context. 57, it says, then said the Jews unto him, Christ, thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? They're like, man, you're not even 50, and you're saying you've seen Abraham? There's no way you're that old. None of them have seen Abraham. Okay, that's a long time ago. So they're mocking him. And then Jesus, who is God, said unto them, verily, verily, truly, truly, this is a fact, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Interesting statement. He says, I am. He knows who he's talking to. He's talking to the Jews. And he purposely chose that phrase because it's a statement of who he is. He's God, ever present. He was there. He was there before Abraham was born. He was there at the creation because he's God. He just so happens to be standing before them in the flesh because he's come in the flesh at this point, but he's still God. Now, in case people are like, oh, well, no, he just was saying, like, you know, he's not really God. 59, verse 59, it says, then took they up stones to cast at him. They were going to kill him. That was their idea, the Jews, because they saw him as just a man who just claimed to be God. And so to them, that's not the case, that he needs to die. It's blasphemous. The sad part is it is God standing in front of them, and they have no idea. They're blinded. But I always find it funny because there's multiple verses. We're going to go over another one, but again, the teens that I teach, they watch a lot of the social media and stuff, and there's people that come on. I've seen these videos, too, that say, oh, Jesus Christ never claimed to be God. It's like, there's one right there where he's, I am. I am that I am. I before Abraham was. That's quite a long time ago, Jesus saying, I am. I am ever present. That's a present tense statement to the people right there, and he's saying that he's present with Abraham right there. Again, showing that he is in all places at all time. Another one we can go to is Mark. Oops. 14, 61. 62. Mark 14, 61, 62. Let's go to 60 just to get more of an idea of what's going on. It says, and the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, saying, answerest thou nothing? What is it which these witnesses against thee? Remember, these are bringing false witnesses. Christ is before the Sanhedrin. They are at an illegal time. There's a whole bunch you can go on to the Passion. I mean, it is completely illegal. Everything's against their actual law on this. There's a whole bunch of stuff wrong. They're standing before him. They've thrown witnesses after witnesses, but they're false witnesses. Why? Because none of them can agree. But so they're like, well, never mind on these witnesses thing. Let's talk to him. Well, hey, these guys are bringing this against you. Aren't you going to say anything? But verse 61, it says, but he held his peace and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said unto him, art thou the Christ, the Son of the Blessed? He just straight up asked, are you the Messiah, Son of God? That's literally what he says. He just went straight for it, went straight for the question. And the interesting part is Jesus does answer. Verse 62, and Jesus said, I am. And ye shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. So, direct question, direct answer. And then, in case you didn't know that he was claiming to be God, just read verse 63. Then the high priest rent his clothes and saith, what need we any further witnesses? Ye have heard the blasphemy. What think ye? And they all condemned him to be guilty of death. Why did they respond that way? Well, one, they want him dead. Yes, we know that. But here's the thing. They're saying blasphemy. Why are they saying blasphemy? Because he just said he was God. Again, he's God. He's there. He's ever present. And I like to point this out because, again, there's lots of people out there that say Jesus never said he was. Yes, he did. He did. He did. Again, we see that he's referring to himself as I am in direct answer. But again, he brings it out and states even more. And then the high priest reacts. Again, the interesting part is when the high priest rent his clothes, that was actually not an act the high priest should have done. So again, just shows the illegalness of everything they're doing, but that's a different study. Turn to Revelation 1. If you want a physical description of Christ, Revelation 1 is the only one kind of with it. Doesn't match any of the paintings. This is a glorified state. Revelation 1, verse 12. This is John. He's about to be given what to write for Revelation. He's going to witness it. He's going to see, and he's going to write down what he sees. But someone meets up with him first. Verse 12, and it says, and I turned, John, to see the voice that spake with me. So he's hearing a voice behind him, and he turns to see. And being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks, and in the midst of the candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. And his head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame. Now notice the as, he's trying to describe it as best he can in the knowledge he has. And his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in the furnace. And his voice is the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. And his countenance was as the sun. He was really bright. Sun shineth in his strength. So this is the sun at his bed, like the strongest. And when I saw him, note who this is. This is John. This is the beloved. This is one of his apostles. This is someone who's been close to him. And he doesn't run over and hug him and say, I've missed you. Oh, it's been so long. No, he falls down as dead. I just note that reaction John has with Christ. He's all powerful. He is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And if when we're in his presence, we will drop. And the reason why I say this is we got to think sober-mindedly about him. Yes, he is our Savior. Yes, we can call him friend. But be careful when you start to bring him to your level of buddy-buddy, okay with the worldly lifestyle. No. Anyway, John falls down at his feet as dead, and he laid, this is Jesus Christ, and he laid his right hand upon me, saying, fear not, I am the first and the last. Now, I want you to note the statement there. Jesus Christ puts his hand down, comforting him. Yeah, this is our Savior. And then he starts to say, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and death. Well, I want you to note, he states, I am the first and the last, Alpha and Omega, the title for God. And in case you didn't know it was Jesus, it says, I am he that liveth and was dead. Well, who's the one that died and rose again? Jesus Christ. So it shows that's Christ. And again, he's stating, I am the first and the last. I am the Alpha and Omega. That's what the voice said before he turned around. This is Christ himself referring to himself as the Alpha and Omega. He is stating he is the great I am. How do we know it's Jesus? Well, verse 18. I am he that liveth and was dead. Okay, so now I'm going to go to the familiar area where most people go. I wanted to show you one that the beginning, it says, in the beginning, God created. So God created Elohim. But Jesus was there because he is God. And I wanted to show you many verses that point to it, but one that just very clearly points is John. Chapter 1, this is the verse that I wanted to say for last on this point because it very clearly points it out. But I wanted you to see that Jesus Christ himself said he was God. And the reason why I wanted to point that out is because sometimes you go to John and people will say, oh, that's just John saying something. That's not Jesus himself claiming it. Well, I wanted to point out the areas where Jesus Christ personally claims it. Now we'll go to more descriptor of his what he did at creation. Chapter 1 starts very similar. John chapter 1, verse 1, starts very similar to Genesis 1:1, except it adds a little bit more. In the beginning was the Word, capital, and the Word, capital, was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. And then we could go a little farther down, verses 14 and 15, and it says, and the Word, which is mentioned in verse 1, the Word was made flesh. So the Word, which created, was there, made everything, became flesh. Well, what's that? Who's that? Jesus Christ. And dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And I like to point out verse 15. It says, John bare witness of him and cried, saying, this was he of whom I spake. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. Why do I want to bring us verse 14? Well, the reason why I bring up verse 14 is, again, critics, people who just want to ignore. And the thing is they'll say, oh, well, it's talking about someone else. It's got to be talking about some other being that became flesh, even though it doesn't make any sense, but they'll do it. Well, guess what? Verse 15 clarifies who, just in case you have any doubt, John the Baptist himself pointed him out and says, there's the Lamb of God. And who did he point to? Jesus Christ. So again, in case you couldn't, someone reading it who's really wanting to be confrontational about it, oh, that's it's probably not talking about Jesus. John 1:29, it says, the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. So the one who came in flesh, who dwelt among us, who is the Word, who created, who was there at the beginning, always existed, doesn't have a beginning himself, is Jesus. He was there. Well, how do we know? John pointed him out. So back to Genesis 1:1. So in the beginning, God created. That's not in the beginning, God started to exist. No, it's in the beginning, God created. He created in our beginning. Creation starts. Time has begun. The verse will finish out with, he creates the space and the matter that's required to do the rest. And it kind of builds on top. I want you to note, by the time he gets to day 6, where he does create us, everything's ready for us there. And the order matters. It requires each other to get there. It all makes sense. We'll go over it in more detail in another lesson. But I want you to note, God just is. The created part in the beginning is our beginning. Our known creation's beginning. God just was and is and forever will be. And Jesus was there because he is God. And part of the Elohim, or Trinity, plurality of God. And in case you're wondering, well, I didn't mention the Holy Spirit. Well, let's just quickly go to verse 2 of Genesis 1. And it says, and earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the water. So in case you're like, where's the Holy Spirit? Oh, he's there as well. Spirit of God moved across the waters. But the thing is, I want you to realize, is God in his Trinity was there. He wasn't created. He created. He created time. That's our beginning. That's all we know. And he's been with us since. And we're going to go over in the next lesson kind of the order, just the beauty of creation. A lot of terms we understand out of creation. Well, where do we get the concept of day? Why do we have this concept called a week? Because here's the interesting part. There's lots of things you could figure out on your own based off the way the universe is designed. You could probably figure out a day. You could probably figure out a month. You could probably figure out a year. But where does week come from? Why do we have a week? There's nothing in the universe that would just make you figure out a week, except it's always a reminder of God. So we'll go more into depth on that. So in conclusion, we see that God just is. He is plural yet one, and that he created all that is necessary for it to work. Time, space, and matter. You either accept it as truth or ignore it. And, well, be the fool in God's eyes, because that's what it is. He straight up calls you a fool if you don't believe it, because it just is. So next lesson, we're going to start going through days of creation. Looking forward to it. Hopefully you are too. Let's pray. Dear Lord, I just thank you so much for today. I thank you so much for this time. I just thank you so much for just allowing us to even get a little glimpse into what you did at the beginning before we even existed. I thank you for the creation. I thank you for your glory. I thank you for sending your son to die for us, Lord. I thank you for all that you do. I pray for the lessons to come. And for those that are still in, I just pray just for the people, Lord. We just love you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, thank you for your time. We got about 16-ish minutes, depending on.